Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to another episode of Let's Build, and hopefully we will be able to finish off Lilly, and I will render her and start compositing her in After Effects so we can get this animation done and just move on to the next thing. Alright, so firstly you may want to see the whole animation. I've gone ahead and completed the keyframes, well, to the best of my ability. So let's take a look and see what we have.
I want one large pizza. Can I get extra cheese, extra sausage, extra pepperoni, extra green pepper? Do you guys put cotton candy on pizza? Why don't you? That's a good idea! Well, fine, I'll go start my own pizza place, and then I'll run you out of business!
So, we've got a nice set of keyframes that get the character acting fairly well. Now, this is obviously not to a feature film level, but it is enough to sell the actions of our character. So what I'm going to do now is I need to fix a few things, and namely some weighting on my mesh down here, because her vertices are sort of just skewing up every now and then, which is not actually what I want. This is actually my fault. During the rigging stage, I did not fix this up. So while I do that, which is going to be a bit of a tedious task, I want to show you guys a very interesting singer down here, and he's fantastic voice. I recommend if you go ahead and take a look at that and just see what he's capable of doing. I was very impressed. Hello to you too.
The world is cruel. The world is wicked. It's I alone whom you can trust in this whole city. I am your only friend. I who keep you, teach you, feed you, dress you. I who look upon you without fear. How can I protect you, boy, unless you always stay in here?
I am deformed,
and you are ugly,
and I am ugly.
These are crimes for which the world show little pity.
You do not comprehend.
You are my one defender.
Out there they'll revile you as a monster.
I am a monster.
Out there they will hate and scorn and jeer.
I am a monster.
Why invite their calumny and consternation?
Stay in here.
Be faithful.
I'm
to
faithful.
Me.
I'm grateful.
Do as I say. Obey and stay in here.
Windows and these parapets of stone, gazing at the people down below me. All my life I watched them as I hide up here alone, hungry for the histories they show me. All my life I memorized their faces, knowing them as they will never know me. All my life I wonder how it feels to pass a day up above them. Day out there, all I ask is one to hold forever. Out there, where they all live on, where what I give, what I dare, just to live one day. The millers and the weavers and their wives, through the roofs and gables I can see them. Every day they shout and scold and go about their lives, heedless of the gift it is to be there. If I was in
makes the morning out there like ordinary men. Freely walk about there just one day, and then I swear I'll be content with my share. Won't resent, won't despair, old and bent, I won't care. I'll have spent one day out there.
Nice. Well, I am very impressed. Well done, Anthony Leiradi. I have to say that is a very, very well sung piece. And I haven't actually, I can't remember Hunchback of Notre Dame because it's been a while since I've seen that. Pardon me. But but I have to say that was an incredible, an incredible voice. So kudos to you, my good friend. Aside from that, if you guys want to take a look at his channel, you can go ahead. I've got the link below. And while I continue working, let's go and continue with today's music playlist. So I've gone ahead and chosen a relaxing and chill out music. As always, guys, if you have any playlist ideas or links you want to share with me, send them over and I'll go ahead and take a look at that. So let's go ahead and start with this. Hopefully it doesn't get too loud. All right, so what you were seeing me do while we were listening to that amazing guy is I was fixing up all these paint weights right here, which is actually screwing up my objects, and I've actually made it even worse. So, it's a bit loud. So what I've done is I've gone ahead and just repainted some of the weights to sort of compromise on the mesh or the vertice weights. And just to hammer it out as best as possible. So now I get a much better deformation around the shoulders, although that little segment is a bit messed up, so I'm gonna have to try and fix that up. But in this particular segment, I'm going to light my character. And what I will do is we'll light the character, get her ready for rendering, and I'll show you guys how to do that. But first, let me just try and fix this up. I know we don't have a lot of time. I'll do my best to just sort of get as much of this right as I can. What I'm trying to do here is scale down that particular... Ooh dear, that's not good. Pardon me. There we go. Okay, so what I'm trying to do is just make sure I get that seam on her shirt strap correct. Right, and that's much better. Pardon me, I've been like this for a very long time. Right. Okay, so let's start lighting our character. And to light your character, I need to draw a very quick diagram. So you have your subject right here. Okay, this is your subject. Now this applies to almost any thing you want to shoot. Maybe it's a short film or interview. But in general, this is also known as the three-point lighting system. Okay, so you have a key light, which comes in this direction. Okay. You have a fill, which goes in this direction. Pardon me. Generally, this is a lot lighter. It's a lot lighter and has a bit more diffuse. And then you also have what's known as a backlight. Okay, and this comes down in this direction. So a three-point lighting system is the most generic starting point for your lighting in general. Obviously, you don't need to use three lights. You can just use one if you have a spooky scene and you just want to get something, you know, working. But in general, this is where you begin with, okay? And this is what I'm going to do in my project right here. Did the music stop? It's just moving on to the next one. That's okay. So the renderer I want to use is called Furryball. Now, Furryball is a free... it's actually a free... Sorry, it's not a free renderer. Sorry, my brain's not working today. It's a hardware renderer that you can go ahead and take a look at in the Furryball website. And basically what they have is it allows you to render stuff in real time using your computer's hardware. It's similar to, say, games, because it uses DirectX 11, and it's much faster as well, and you get some pretty good results. Now, the difference between Furryball and Mental Ray is the fact that Mental Ray does everything far more realistically. It literally calculates photons coming off the character's body, and depending on the values and the material values in your scene or your lighting values, it renders pretty much per pixel almost, okay? Now, obviously that's going to be a lot slower, but in my case, I don't need my character to be super realistic. All I need is just to render her out as an example for everyone to just sort of see. So I'm not worried about quality of the render, so to speak. What I want is just something that's readable. Now, this is the default lighting system. I don't have any lights in there, so by default it just has a light in front of the camera. And you can see we've got some subsurface scattering coming through our character right here. Now, we need to begin with a three-point lighting system, and I've already created a mail script that creates this for me. So what I'm going to do is just do that. So we just go to three-point lighting default. Again, this is a custom script, so you won't have this, but what it basically does is it creates three lights, like the three-point lighting system you can see right here. Obviously we need to adjust the positions of these lights. So all I have, so what I have actually is a key light right here. I have a fill light on the left side and a backlight. Okay. And what we need to do is I need to change some of the settings down here. So let me just bring up my outliner, because I won't be able to see those objects. So I have my key light, fill, and back. And these are area lights, so they'll give us nice soft shadows. Oh, pardon me. I think it's bugged again. This is not good. It's very bizarre. Sometimes Furball does this, but I'm not sure why. How wonderful. I'm about to show you guys an example, and now it's not working. Let me try this. Put one light inside, just a point light, to see what we get. Oh, that is very creepy. Okay, it's not updating. I need to restart my Maya. One moment. Okay, much better. That was a very bizarre bug. So happens every now and then. So I'm gonna get rid of my point light. So what you see right here is the three key lights. Sorry, the three area lights that I showed you just before. And what I'm going to do is just start adjusting some of these levels right here. Okay, now this, the problem with the area lights in Furryball specifically is that you won't be able to get any subsurface scattering. So I need to mix this in with something like a point light or a directional light. So in my particular case, what I'm going to do is go ahead and fix up the color. And I don't want it to be completely white. I just want a very slight yellow in here. And I'm going to bump the intensity up ever so slightly. So you can see we've got some nice shadows on our character. And these are soft shadows as well, so... Okay. Alright, fill light is going to be slightly less intense, because it's the purpose of a fill light is just to fill that shadow in. Okay, so I've just turned it off, and when we do that, we get some nice, just a nice balance between the key light and the fill light right there. And finally, the backlight, it can, depending on what you want, you can bump it up really high. I probably don't want to do that. It's up to you. But the idea here is to try and get some nice lines, edge lines or silhouette lines across our character's back. This helps our character pop out of our scene much more strongly, because sometimes our character tends to blend into the background, and that's not what we want. We want the key point of the scene to sort of pop out. Okay. My case, I'm going to just leave it as at one, but I do want to change the color to something a lot warmer. Simply because we can afford to do that. Right. So that's our area lights. Oh dear, this is not good for my throat. So our area lights are pretty much there. Alright, let's head back to my default just so that I can see my things. And what I'm going to do is create a point light system. So the point light, I'm going to begin by sticking it on the back of my area light right here. So point light one will be back point. Let's see what we get. Now, using a point light system, you will get subsurface scattering, okay? That's just how furry ball works at the moment. So don't ask me why. But you need a point light or spotlight or even a direction light to get the subsurface scattering out. But once we've got that, you can see we can get some nice... We get a nice silhouette on there. Now, you may be thinking to yourself, wow, that looks pretty good on default settings. Actually, the material was not a default setting. I actually had to tweak it a lot in a previous project, and what I did was I saved the subsurface scattering preset. So if I go to my material here, okay, this is the material that it has been applied to my Lilly character, and if I go into my attribute editor, okay, so that's our material right here. Well, even better, I might just open up the node work area here. You can see that I've created a furry ball node. Now, this furry ball node enables extra settings like subsurface scattering in our case. And what I've done is gone ahead and played around the settings until I got something that I liked. Okay, so that looks really nice. You've got some nice, soft subsurface scattering coming out of her skin. And that just adds a little bit more realism to this particular character. The other thing that I've also added, once again, this is a furry ball feature, is what's called velvet strength, and this helps bring some silhouettes, the silhouette of our character on the edges, out a lot more. Okay, and it's great because we can, you know, have a play around with it, and this helps bring the material out, or makes the material a lot more readable. Okay, so it doesn't look like a flat 3D character. It actually looks like it's a bit more organic, since organic skin, for example, does not look flat in color. There's some kind of silhouette that comes out the side when you have lighting there. Alright, so with that done, I'm gonna just close that. Let's duplicate the backlight, and I'm gonna stick it on the key light here. Just hold V and snap it to my key light. So this will be key point. Now this is very, very bright because it's the point light is now on top of our area light, so I need to either bring my key light down or the area light down. But I'm going to do that for both, so I'll just leave the area light at 0.6 just to start off with, and then for the point light, I might turn it down to maybe 0.6 as well. And for this, let's bring the color to something a little bit more colorful. I'm thinking she'll be indoors, so I want her to be inside with... Sorry, I want her to be... to show out as inside lighting. If you want, you can also add shadows as well, but you're going to get some problems unless you bump up the resolution. So I'm going to just put a value there, see what we get. Not too bad. Might turn off shadows for the moment. Okay. Last thing is that we're getting a lot of shadows underneath her arms and all that. Now this is kind of realistic lighting, okay, which is okay, but because there is a table here, I want to emulate some kind of lighting that sort of comes off the table. And this is a very subtle thing, so it's called ambient emissive. Now I don't have settings that do this, so I need to do it manually, okay? So within my scene, I might use an area light. So default quality rendering. I'll grab the back. and just aim up. I need to make sure I turn off my shadows, because I don't want any shadows hiding in that light. I just want that lighting to just come up directly over her. And this will be very, very subtle, so I'll probably turn it down to 0.2 or something. I'll start at 0.3. Let's take a look and see our result. So you can see this is what's called ambient emissive. It's basically light or global illumination if you're using mental ray. Basically light coming off other objects reflecting onto our character. Okay, so this is without it. And if we just pump it up ever so slightly, you can see you can get a much more realistic result, like so. Now the other thing we need to do is just adjust the fill light. And also her eyes. Pardon me again. So what I want to do is go ahead and grab just these two eyelids. And I want to apply this Fong material. Hope it doesn't crash. So there we go. What I want to try and do is see if I can get any... I probably can't get reflectivity, that's totally fine. But what's more important is the fact that I want her eyes to sort of pop out a little bit, so I might add a tiny, tiny bit of ambient color. Just the smallest amount. Okay, that will help our character come just pop out a little bit more. Another thing we may also want to do is I feel the key light maybe, or the key point light maybe a bit too low. Let's just bring her up. Might also bring the fill light down ever so slightly. Alright, looking great. So this is how you generally light your scene. There are many different ways you can do it. But in my particular case, this is how I just want to bring my character out. And again, lighting in itself, it is a bit of an art form. So for me, I'm not too concerned about making it look super realistic. All I want to do is just get her to look readable, render her out and get this done. Get this done and over with. Because you tend to just want to move on to the next thing. So that's pretty well lit already. I'm quite satisfied with that. There are a few other things missing, for example, ambient occlusion, which we can add. And there's something called a screen space ambient occlusion, which is real-time ambient occlusion, but it's simulated using just mathematical vectors, etc., all that stuff. It's much faster than using something like mental ray to create your ambient occlusion, so that will add a lot of realism to it. All right, so I'm gonna go to my furball node. Into my global illumination settings and just to see if I can bring that ambient occlusion out. Maybe missing. Go to my features node, just make sure it's on. And it wasn't even on, so that's why. So that's our ambient occlusion. Okay. And if you don't know what that is, it's basically just soft shadows that come on the edges of our meshes. And this helps bring the realism out even more. So I'll try and get the ambient occlusion there, so that's what ambient occlusion generally looks like. Okay, so you got nice shadows underneath. I want to actually mess around with these settings, so let me just try and get something that kind of works. So I'm going to bring out as much of that ambient occlusion as possible, because I can adjust this in post. Basically, I can adjust it in After Effects, maybe crush the blacks even more and such. So I want to get as much ambient occlusion information as I can. Great. So that's looking really nice. Okay, this is what's called screen space ambient occlusion. All right, let's go back here and go back to my beauty. So that's looking nice. One other thing I may try. Might just smooth that character's mesh out. I don't know what this will do. I'm just trying it out just to see. It's a bit slow. Oh, I really hope it didn't crash. So Lilly looks better when it's like that, but I might just leave her. Gotta save this work. Might just leave her at just normal pixelation. Sorry, normal tessellation. Because I want this character to be pretty low poly anyway. Alright. Great. I'm happy with that. Position. So look through selected, let's just zoom out and find a nice angle. So I'm gonna go render settings and change this to a decent resolution, so 1920 by 1080. Right, so I am currently in my camera right now, so I'm gonna turn my resolution gate on and also maybe title safe if I wanted to. Oops. Sorry. So that's my resolution gate. And I don't know what I did. Oh, unbelievable. There we go. Sorry. Okay, so that's my resolution gate. This is basically where it will render. Just try and make sure she's in the scene.
One large pizza.
Need less headroom.
Can I get extra cheese?
Great. Now you notice I'm not doing it in front. That's because during my animation, and this is because I didn't plan it out correctly, is I lose a bit of a solid drawing. Okay, so we don't really see her eyes. So to get better readability, I need to just pan the camera ever so slightly to the side. Now for an animation like this, it's no big deal. But if you have a director and you're working on a film or an animation, and you didn't plan this, then you'd be in trouble. You would have to start again, or you'd have to actually fix that last pose, okay? So if the camera is locked off and that's what the director wants, you need to make sure you plan ahead and just ensure that you have a good camera angle. Make sure you have a camera angle locked off so that you know what the director wants. All right, so we're going to just, I'll put it on this side here. So I'm quite happy with that. So take a look one more time at our furry ball settings. Hopefully this will won't crash this computer. I think it's something starting to go wrong now. There we go. Great. Now we don't have a background, that's fine. We're going to create a background. Alright, so we'll I might just move that crayon back a bit. So let's start rendering this out. Go back to my perspective mode. Just double check and make sure my crayons are snug on the table there. Alright, this is how you set it up in Furball for me. Mental Ray, obviously, you need to do things differently. You've got to set up your render layers. Mental Ray is a little bit easier because you only need to set up these passes, except for a few other layers like Z Depth or Ambient Occlusion. But you just go in here and then you select the render layers that you want, okay? Now, I don't have a tutorial that covers all of this because Mental Ray can be very tricky to use. It's, again, it is another specialization that if you want to get into, you have to do a lot of in-depth training, okay? Because there are just so many settings, so many things you got to keep in mind. I can't go through all that because I don't have enough training in this. I know how to use it basically, but for me personally, that's not something that I can teach. But you can go ahead and take a look at that. Other internet tutorials, or even go to places like digitaltutors.com and check out how to create that. Okay, so but how to create your render layers, that's how you do it in using Mental Ray. We're going to do an equivalent in Furball. So what I have here is the default, which was the beauty. So I'm going to call this the beauty pass. I'm going to duplicate the node again. Remember, I'm creating individual render layers right here. So I'll call this AO, which is Ambient Occlusion. Now, if I go to my renderer, actually, I probably won't do that because it is running a bit slow now. So, but to do that, just my output pass, I want to make sure it's Ambient Occlusion, okay? So that's the node. Let's duplicate the beauty again. Call this the specular. I may not need that many render layers at all. Because again, I'm not too concerned about post quality. I just want to get my animation done. And we'll put this as specular down here. Just make sure we double check our features. So it's looking good. For beauty, I might make sure I've got color bleeding as well. Okay, so that's ambient occlusion. Our beauty pass, which we all know. And our specular pass, which basically comes off on the phone, etc. Let's duplicate this again, and I might call this color bleed. Color bleed, if you don't know what that is in Furball, it's as far as I can tell, it's a very good equivalent of global illumination. So let's turn this shadow to color bleeding. Let's just check out color bleed layer. So global illumination, it's very subtle, but you can see that the light reflecting off our characters' shirts, etc. And that will just help with more realism. I'm pretty sure I don't need a Z-depth, but Z-depth helps you get some nice lens or post-production camera blur or lens distortions, etc. Just trying to figure out what I need. I probably don't need that. Maybe I do. I'll just turn this on. I'll put it out anyway. Shadows I won't need. Reflections I won't need, because that's not a key factor here. Most likely I may need diffuse. Let's just check. I may not need it at all because I do have a beauty pass. Diffuse is okay. I think that'll do for us. I won't render the diffuse. So what the basic things that I'll need is the beauty pass, specular, color bleed, and ambient occlusion. All right. So I'm gonna go to my output. Let's highlight ambient occlusion, beauty, color bleed, and specular. Make sure the image format is PNG. I will head up and just try and. This will be a sequence, and the end frame. Let's put it to 580. End frame will be 580. Great. Okay, looking good. All right, camo is camo 1, derived from Maya. As far as I know, everything should be okay. And where this is going to save, if I browse, that's not actually good. Let's just see where this is going to go. So this will go to my project, images, and scene name. So if I just go to my... Okay, so this is my folder. This is where my project is currently linked to. It will save under my images, okay? Right here. So let's render this out and then we'll finish up with some compositing and get this done. So depending on how fast your computer is, obviously this will take some time. Okay, so it looks like we have our render complete. What I'm going to do is head over into After Effects. Set some music while we're working. And I'm going to import them in. So that's actually the wrong one. Oh, pardon me. Set into my image. Sorry, my characters. So what I've done is I've copied all those images into my folder here. This is where my project is, and in here I've got that's my After Effects project, and these are all of my rendered images. Alrighty, let's go list. So I'm going to import the ambient occlusion. Let's import the next set, which will be the beauty, somewhere in the middle. Okay, so we've got our sequences in there. Go to my specular and my color bleed, and I think that's just four of them as far as I can recall. So the render took about an hour, which is really fast for animation like this. So we'll call this Lilly orders pizza, and let's just make it a 30-second scene. Alright, so our composition is ready. We're going to bring these in and do a little bit of basic color grading and add some backgrounds as well, okay? Oh, there's one other thing I forgot. That was actually... no, I think it'll be okay. Because I've got my alpha channel there already. Pardon me. So this is my beauty pass. I'm going to add on top of that will be the ambient occlusion. Now, the beauty pass has all of the specular and everything on there, but that's okay. Not too worried about that. So what I've done is I've added the ambient occlusion on top. Okay, so that's with and without. I have to create a white background. Okay, so that's with ambient occlusion and without. So this will bring out some realism on our character here, okay? So we see that she's moving quite well. Okay, so the next thing I want to do is put the specular on top of our ambient occlusion. And you can see we've got those little white specks there. Let's turn this to an add, just to bring out some of that specularity on the phone and her face as well. Looking great. Color bleed is really, really subtle, but you can just put an add on top. I'm going to look for my curves, just apply it to my color bleed. And you can see that's where our color bleed will show up. I'm going to do the same for my for my specularity. So you can bring the specularity up, even though it is quite subtle, it can help just sort of tweak some of your settings here. Alright, let's change the specularity to slight orange, just to warm it up a little bit. And with my beauty pass, I'm going to drag my curve on top of the beauty pass. And just bring out some of those mids up. Okay. Alright. I'm going to create a new composition. This will be the final render. Oh, actually, this will be the base comp. Don't worry if you don't know what that means. I'm just going to put it down here because I want to isolate just the background Well, actually, I want to isolate the background away from that, so I'm going to pull my beauty pass, and because my beauty pass has an alpha channel, let's turn the track matte to alpha matte, so we get our transparency back. All right, and now all that's a matter, all that we need to do now is just bring a solid color, put it in the back, just behind her, and to bring out a little bit of depth in that background, I'm just going to create another solid and turn it into a bit of a gradient. Okay, so this helps bring out a flat texture, because we don't want a flat texture. We generally want just nice, some nice gradient at the very least. I may switch that to a subtract. So that kind of brings it out, brings her out a little bit more. All right. Let me brighten that up. And if you want, you can also add maybe a third, just a third mask here. Oh, pardon me. Great. And this is going to basically be just another lighting or another gradient just to help bring her forward. Alrighty. Let's mess around with the background a bit. Maybe we can get something that may look a little bit better. It all depends, really. You sort of need to play around these settings and see what works and see what doesn't. There's no real hard and fast rule, generally. So it's a good idea to just experiment a little bit and find something that you think might work. That and do the same on the other side as well, just so that way you can emphasize a little bit of a slight lighting effect. Alright, I want to go back to my composition here and just adjust the ambient occlusion, because I think it's a bit too strong. So I'm going to go to my curves, isolate that a bit, and just lighten that out. Brighten that out ever so slightly. Well, in our case, it's not really that slight, but it gives us a better result. Alright, last few steps, and we're pretty much done with this. And I'll do a little bit of audio engineering, although that's not my forte. I know probably bare basics. So I've put another adjustment layer on top of everything. And what I want to do is just bring that definition out even more. So I might bring the blacks down just so that we have more color definition, more contrast. And on top of this, I'm gonna go to my red channel and just pull the low reds down and keep the high reds up. This gives us some nice green shadows, okay? And this is a very standard, so to speak, film color grading technique. You see this very commonly in pretty much any movie, so you may not notice it, but it's kind of just good to sort of keep that in mind. If you're ever unsure what grade you want, you can just pull the low reds down. Just want to bring that ever so slightly up. Color grading, again, is another art form in itself. I wouldn't be doing it as quickly as I did here. I would spend a lot more time. Well, at least professionals will spend far more time just tweaking the color grades until it looks really nice. But in my case, I don't really care. For me, it's all about just getting it done. Okay, so let's put a vignette around her. let me turn this down ever so slightly. And for this, I'm going to turn the mask to a subtract and just feather that out. Now, vignette is useful because generally cameras, even film cameras, don't capture everything. You have slight distortions on the edges of your image. So I'm just going to put a very small vignette there. Maybe put a multiply. Maybe even a darken. No, I think I'm pretty happy with that. So now we can see the emphasis is on Lilly. Lighting looks great. Background is very plain, but it's just enough to show us what this animation is all about. Great. Very pleased with it. Let me just see what I can get from that. No, I'm not much of a fan of that. Don't worry if you don't know what I was doing. I was just testing out some just a bit of a lighting experimentation. Again, I don't have any I'm not running with any rules in my head. I'm just trying to see if I can emphasize her a little bit more. Maybe bring a little bit of extra realism into the scene. I don't think I'm going to be successful in this round. Maybe if I planned a little bit more, but probably not. I kind of like it on top of there. So I might move everything underneath the grating. And I think I'm pretty happy with that. What do you guys think? So before I render that out, I need to do a little bit of audio engineering, okay? So basically, we've recorded this using her mic, and all the audio you've heard up to this point is very raw. So to bring out that audio, or just to brighten that up a little bit, we need to do some audio engineering. This is also known as post audio. Now, I didn't mention already, I am not a post audio engineer. I don't have the ears for that, so I don't have any experience in doing this. But what I did was I did learn from a good friend of mine, and he just gave me some basic tips on how to get a very generic audio post working. So what I'm going to do is, I don't actually have that file, so I may have to bring up my Adobe Premiere. So this is our voice artist compile. It's got a collection of various things.
I want one large pizza. Can I get extra cheese, extra sausage, extra pepperoni, extra green pepper? Do you guys put cotton candy on pizza? Why don't you? That's a good idea. Well, fine, I'll go start my own pizza place, and then I'll run you out of business.
Okay, so this is Meredith Sims, our voice actress. She's given us our Lilly recording, and what I've done is I've just cut it down, timed it down until I got something that I'm happy with. But now we need to do some audio engineering, so I need to... You can see that there's so many peaks here and there. Ooh, pardon me, that's my phone. So we have a lot of peaks and dips down here, so the audio isn't equal. So we need to equalize a lot of this, and then obviously we've got to put it through an EQ and just make it sound brighter. So I'm going to bring this into my Adobe Audition. And I'm just trying to remember how I can do that. I think I can send it straight to audio, Adobe Audition. I just can't remember where I do it. There we go. So sequence, pizza ordering, everything's all good. And we'll just bring that in. So let's go ahead and take a look at this. Oh, I'm moving it.
I want one large pizza. Can I get extra cheese, extra sausage, extra pepperoni, extra green pepper?
All right, first thing I want to do is start balancing this out. This is also called compressing. So what I'm going to do is go to just select them all, or even better, you can select the whole track. And then over here you have the effects rack. Okay, so the effects rack for audio one, I can add all kinds of little effects here. First thing I want to do is add a compression. And I'm just trying to find, actually no, I have to do that to the clips first. If anyone knows any good audio tutorials, please let me know. I'd be glad to learn them. I'm definitely not the best teacher when it comes to audio or music. So let's take a look and see what we can do. So multi-band compressor. I'm just trying to think if that's correct. That should be right, I hope.
Do you guys put cotton candy on pizza? Why don't you? That's a good idea!
Alright, I want to bring this down to point minus 6 dB.
I'll go start my own pizza place, and then I'll run you out of business.
So now you can hear that the...
I want one large pizza. Can I get extra cheese, extra sausage, extra pepperoni, extra green pepper? Do you guys put cotton candy on pizza? Why don't you? That's a good idea. Well, fine, I'll go start my own pizza.
Okay, so it sounds much more even. So we have less dips and less peaks as well, or a lot less clipping. So you can have a play around with these settings. I'm going to leave it as it is, and we'll move on to the last bit, which is going to be an EQ.
And large pizza.
So under my audio here, I'm going to go and add an EQ, graphic equalizer, and what I want to do is just bump her bass up, as well as her. The treble? I think that's what you call the treble.
Can I get extra cheese, extra sausage, extra pepperoni, extra green pepper? Do you guys put cotton candy on pizza? Why don't you? That's a good idea! Well, fine, I'll go start my own pizza place, and then I'll run you out of business! I want one large pizza. Can I get extra cheese, extra sausage, extra pepperoni, extra green pepper? Do you guys put cotton candy on pizza?
Okay, that's good enough for me.
Why don't you? That's a good idea!
So we're done with that post, as far as I'm concerned. You can tell that I'm going to leave it as it is. I'll definitely have to get some more tips and tricks from real audio engineers, but for now we'll leave that as it is. I'm going to save this out. If I can remember how. I'm just trying to remember. Unbelievable. It's always the weird projects that I seem to struggle with. How do I export? It's not letting me, and it's being mean. Unless I can send it back. So export to, might be bounce. That sounds about right, I think.
Well, fine, I'll go start my own pizza plate.
So, mute that.
And then I'll run you out of business. Let's put cotton candy, extra cheese, extra sausage,
Okay, that pop there is not going to be good. I might lose that.
Can I get extra cheese, extra sausage, extra
Okay, so that sounds about right. I'm guessing when you bounce something, it sort of renders it out, so that's my theory in any case. Unbelievable. I'm terrible at this thing. I can't seem to zoom out, and it's not letting me. It's being really naughty. There we go.
Extra cheese, extra sausage, extra pepperoni, extra green pepper. Do you guys put cotton candy on pizza? Pizza.
Alright, Let me see if I can export this out or even send it back. I'll just export to Premiere Pro. Alright, export. I'm trying to keep it around minus 6 dB. Although different...
Green pepper. Do you guys put
different broadcasts will require different different levels, so...
Cotton candy on
again,
pizza.
I don't have any expertise in that, so I'll leave it as it is. So what I'll do now is I'm going to export this as a WAV file. Call this pizza ordering post. We'll bring this into After Effects. And then we'll render out our entire scene. So firstly, I want to just fix up all of these folders. So I'll call this final render. All right, let's bring in our audio. Oh dear, I closed that down, didn't I? Let's try that again. Let's bring in our audio. And bring in our post audio right here. Let's just drag it down to the bottom. And if you hold control, you'll be able to hear that, okay? All right, so what I'll do is now I'll go ahead and add to render queue, and we're going to export this out. And then we'll be pretty much done. Just make sure you have audio output on. Usually you will render this in Premiere, okay, in your editing program. But because this is just one scene, we don't have to worry about that. So I'm just going to render it as it is. And then I'll go ahead and do this. So we've got AE exports. So Lily orders pizza. All right. Okay, so while this is rendering, we will finish this up here, and then I will see you guys in the next episode of Let's Build. Catch you guys around.